In this week's space news, Aspire Space reusable rockets from the United Arab Emirates. Aspire is building a rapidly reusable rocket to compete with SpaceX and other US launchers. Founded by veterans from Soyuz, Zenit, Sea Launch and even Buran, Aspire's new launcher can lift 15 tons to low Earth orbit. Their first stage will be a 2000 kN Methalox engine. The full-size engine stands over 2 meters tall and is constructed using the latest advances in 3D printing. Aspire Space is relocating its headquarters from Luxembourg to the Emirates, a big boost for the United Arab Emirates' growing space ambitions. The next milestone for the company is a planned hot fire campaign of their second stage engine in 2026. First launch is targeted for 2030 on an aggressive timescale. Stan Rudenko, the CEO of Aspire, said, "Sovereign access to space and rapid reusability are foundational to participating in one of the world's most dynamic and aspirational sectors. We are excited to help the Emirates take a bold next step as a spacefaring nation," unquote. Beyond its orbital launcher, Aspire is designing a reusable spacecraft capable of transporting up to 2 metric tons of payload to and from orbital stations, further expanding its vision for space exploration. Okay, on to our second story this week. EU Space Act – Impact on Space Startups. The European Commission has released a proposal for an EU Space Act this week. EU stands for European Union, which consists of 27 European countries. The aim of the act is to cut red tape by creating one legal standard and set of technical requirements, but the fear is it will pile on extra work and costs to European space startups. The Space Act outlines operating procedures for various aspects of the space sector, including launch licensing, satellite safety, and space debris management. The impact on the commercial sector could be substantial, especially for small startups that don't have the staff or the money to comply with all the new paperwork. An assessment found that the manufacturing costs of satellites could increase by 10%. Launch service providers could end up incurring costs of €1.5 million for heavy launchers and €200,000 for small and medium launchers in order to meet the new regulations. Smaller startups may need to hire additional staff to manage compliance, further driving up operational costs. The Act also introduces stringent environmental and safety measures. Launch operators must implement flight safety systems to ensure safe launches and re-entries, including measures to control space debris. Operators are required to equip satellites and spacecraft with in-space servicing interfaces to support future safe disposal by other spacecraft. Additionally, systems to prevent collisions with space debris and to minimize light and radio pollution are mandatory. Moreover, space operators must calculate and submit the environmental footprint of their entire mission lifecycle as part of the launch licensing process, adding another layer of complexity and cost. These requirements, while aimed at enhancing safety and sustainability, may negatively affect smaller startups, potentially harming their competitiveness in the global commercial space race. Speaking of European space startups, let's move on to the third story this week in space news. Latitude commits €8 million to launch facility in French Guiana. Latitude Space, a French launch provider, has announced their first launch of their Zephyr rocket will take place from the Guiana Space Center in French Guiana. This is a primary spaceport for the European Space Agency, home to Ariane 6 and Vega rocket launches. The company is investing €8 million to build a dedicated launch facility at the site of the former Diamant launch complex. The Guiana Space Center's launch area can support up to 5 launch companies, accommodating a combined total of 40 launches annually. PLD Space, another European launch provider, is also set to operate from this spaceport, with launches planned for late 2025 or early 2026. Standing 19 meters tall, the two-stage Zephyr rocket can deliver up to 200 kilos to low Earth orbit. Latitude has also secured a contract with the Saxeford spaceport, which is ideal for sun-synchronous and polar orbits. In contrast, the Guiana Space Center's near-equatorial location makes it optimal for equatorial launch missions. Latitude expects its first launch will take place sometime in 2026. In other news about Latitude, the company is working on a new 25,000 square meter manufacturing facility capable of producing up to 50 Zephyr rockets per year. Latitude received funding from the French government under a First Factory initiative. This program supports startups in establishing their first industrial production site on French soil. Latitude continues hot fire tests of its flight-ready Navio rocket engine, which powers the Zephyr rocket. The company is also building a replica of its launch facility in France to conduct integration tests ahead of its rocket's first flight next year. Okay, on to our last story this week. Argo Space Navigator Spacecraft. Argo Space Corporation is launching an experimental demonstration of its Navigator spacecraft. This spacecraft is interesting because of the use of a water-fed microwave electrothermal thruster propulsion system, or MET for short. Water is abundant throughout the solar system, so a highly efficient water-based propulsion system would be ideal for moving around in space. MET systems, in theory at least, are capable of specific impulse of 800 seconds, much higher than chemical thruster engines. Launch is tentatively scheduled for 1st of February 2026 on board SpaceX's Falcon 9 Transporter 16 mission from Vandenberg Space Force Base. The mission aims to showcase the Navigator's water-fueled propulsion and its capability to transport payloads from low Earth orbit to a geostationary graveyard orbit. After deploying into low Earth orbit, the spacecraft will adjust its orbit to a highly elliptical path, reaching a maximum distance of 80,000 kilometers from Earth while maintaining its initial inclination. It will then alter its inclination and circularize its orbit to settle into a GEO graveyard orbit. This mission serves as a technology demonstration and a stepping stone for Argo Space's LEO to GEO rideshare platform, paving the way for future commercial space operations. The primary mission is expected to last 12 months, with the potential to extend operations for up to 2 years. This spacecraft ties directly to my recent video on mining series, where a conference paper highlighted the MET propulsion system as the ideal method for transporting water across the solar system. The Navigator's upcoming demonstration mission marks an exciting step towards realizing this vision. Okay, that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon!